first from the Cape Breton Oilers right here, Bill McDougall. Put it right there. Put it down. Now let's everybody go. Domi, 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 Domi. There he is. Hi, Domi. Ty, let's just get something straight here. Can you imagine this guy in 16 games scored 26 goals? Get this now, 26 assists. That's a career for some guys.
So what are you trying to say?
Can you imagine? Bill, I mean, tell us about it. It must have been unbelievable.
Well, I kind of shocked myself, more or less. So we got on a good roll. I had two good line mates going with me.
Who are they now?
David Hodge and Roman. David just signed with Calgary, and Roman's back with Edmonton next year. And we pulled together, and just every game, we never stopped.
Boy, I'll tell you, and you win the Calder Cup. Unbelievable. Tell us about that.
Well, you know what it's like when the Calder Cup.
I guess I do. I was on three of them, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, it's quite a thrill, especially, you know, for the fans of Cape Breton. They've never really won anything like that down there, so they supported us all year. We had a full house every night, and they're there right till the end, and they're hanging over the glass with the champagne bottles with us.
Packed. They were packed. There was one guy who was a fisherman. Listen to this one. I was a fisherman. Dave Hinkley, I think his name, or something like that. He went to 79 games last year. I mean, that's unbelievable.
They really support the team down there.
Well, I'll tell you, that is really something. We got a little clip just showing, you know, a little clip right here. We always have it. Blues got it. You'll roll that little clip right now. Coming up with the Calder Cup. Bill and the Calder Cup. Here it is.
8 seconds to go. At the center ice, Circle takes the puck and dumps it in. And there it is. The Cape Breton Oilers. The Calder Cup champions.
We just announced the most valuable player in the playoffs.
What a surprise.
Yeah, surprise, surprise. He only had 51 points in what, 16 games?
You went to Hockey Heaven, New York Rangers, that's what Mike Keenan says, by the way, and you were the most popular guy there, and all of a sudden they traded you. What's going on here? Why?
Well, I got to a situation where, you know, when you're not playing, you're not happy, and I wasn't playing for 12 games in a row, and I finally had to be asked to move, which was probably the toughest thing I ever did in my life, but, you know, you're always happy when you're playing.
Well, I guess you go to Hockey Heaven, Winnipeg. Geez, you go there, you got posters and commercials and the whole deal, right?
Yeah.
You and Chris King.
Yeah, it was great. Chris and I got there, and the team kind of got on a roll.
On a roll, they won 11 straight. Not bad.
I think it was because of luck.
Wow, that's bad, not bad. 11 straight. And Timo Salami, Timo Salami, Timo Salami threw a foot.
Hey, great, cool.
Oh, yeah, Eli Timo's his friend, eh? As long as Timo's there, he's going to be there. You know, that's up there. Anyhow, no wonder you like him. Watch this clip we got coming up of Timo Salami. Coming right up here.
Watch this one. Puts it up on the left side for Salami. Salami moving in with Domi. Over to Domi. He scores! You know, people talk about Ty Domi's toughness.
Right, he got 400 goals last year, and we show his one. That's the kind of guy I am, anyhow, right there. And now he comes right now, the captain of the league, Wendel. People out west are going to be happy about this now. Where were you born and raised?
Kelvington, Saskatchewan. Born and raised.
Boy, I'll tell you. Talk about hockey. You got Barry Melrose comes from there, or Billy Ray Cypress. You know Billy Ray Cypress.
Barry comes from there. And
these are Toronto fans here, folks.
Joey Kosher and Corey Kosher and Kerry Clark and...
Boy, I'll tell you, little community, a lot of tough guys come from there.
Another Boston Bruin, Lloyd Gronzall out of Calvinton, playing
the
Boston Bruin.
Yeah, well, we got to get a Bruin in there, right? Now, all right, we say right off the bat, you know, I love this at the start. I like to say, what helped you the most on the way up, like your coaches and that? I like, can you remember the...
Probably the person that helped me the most on the way up would have been my father. He he coached pretty much most of the hockey when I grew up in Calvinton. And then when I went from there, I guess when I played midget hockey in
Where did you play that?
In midget hockey, I played Notre Dame and getting coached by Barry McKenzie and Terry O'Malley.
Yeah. Your teammates in Notre Dame, give us a few of them.
Teammates, Terry Perkins, Bob Joyce, Brad Lauer, Paul Moore, Paul Girard, all players that played
good
college
grinders,
or
I'll tell you.
Drafted. And
now, you know, Saskatoon Juniors, you know, we here in the East, we don't sometimes think of the way they work and go out there. In the winter, those trips are murder out there, aren't they?
Well, you have some quite long road trips. Playing in Saskatoon, I think once or twice a year, you have a road trip that's 8 to 10 days long, where you go out and you play six games in 8 days. Bus 28 hours out, and you play all the teams on the way back.
I tell you, you know, this is no kidding. They talk about when the scouts are alone in that, they talk about character. And that Western, those guys out there, if you can survive that, you can survive anything. Now, the world, now, Saskatoon, good club, not a bad club at all, eh?
Well, a great hockey club. Darryl Lubinicki's been the general manager there for 9 or 10 years now, and they've been to Memorial Cup once, and they've come close a couple other times, and they've had a lot of great runs at it.
Boy, they love their hockey in Saskatoon, don't they?
They love it. They've been pushing for a big team there for a long time.
Almost got her.
It came close, but I think junior hockey is where it should stay. In
great, nice arena now, eh? They've got a beauty.
Well, it's got a great one. 8,000 to 10,000 people they can fit in there for hockey.
Yeah. Now, you go to 1985, you go to the World Junior. Tell us about that. Won the gold.
Well, in 85, I was fortunate enough to be asked to World Junior Camp by Terry Simpson, and I think I was one of the last to make it as an extra defenseman, extra forward. They didn't know what they were going to use me as, and it was just a great experience for myself.
Now, I have to laugh. The story that Harold tells, and by the way, Harold, you were one of Harold's favorites. A lot of people around now that he's dead, God love him, put the knock on him, but the players really did like him, didn't they?
Well, Harold was a character person. He liked to do things maybe a little opposite of everybody else, but he had a lot of fun with it. That was his fun in life. But he always got along very well with all the players. He was on all the road trips, in the dressing room all the time, and he was like he was almost like one of the guys for an owner.
Well, a lot of people don't realize that. They think that, you know, he was an ogre up there or something. The players loved him. I know that. Now, you come to Toronto, the thing he loved. You're 18 years old, number one draft pick. You drive up in a taxi and walk in. I mean, now they got agents dropping out of the trees after them, but he loved that. How come you did that? Just drive up.
I don't know. I took a cab from the hotel I was at a meeting the day before the draft. One of the usual meetings players have at the draft. So I went in the hot stove lounge and sat down and had lunch with Mr. Ballard and Jerry McNamara and Dan Maloney and John Brophy at the time.
Boy. Try that now, folks. I'll tell you, there's about 50 lawyers between them. Now, in Saskatoon, you play defense. Your last year, you get 32 goals and 55 assists. Now, and 253 minutes in penalties, too, by the way. Now, who was the idea to put you up forward?
Well, in World Junior, I played half the games defense and half the games in forward. I made it as a forward on the fourth line in the World Junior, and I played defense in the power play. And junior and all my career, I played defense until I got to Toronto. And first day of training camp, Dan Maloney says, you're playing left side. And I've been left winger ever since.
Your dad would like you to go and play defense.
My dad still thinks I can play defense. I don't play backwards anymore, but he still thinks I can play defense.
Well, I'll tell you, you had 34 goals. Sporting News picked your Rookie of the Year. Hockey News picked your Rookie of the Year. The sports writers didn't pick you Rookie of the Year, but what do they know? Now, another great year coming up. The next year, you had 37 goals. Everything's sailing along beautiful. The one thing I don't understand, I can never understand, you're not a big guy. You're about 5'11", 185, 190 pounds. Around that, anyhow.
Winter weight.
That's the winter weight. But 180, that's... No, but I could never understand. You did all the hitting back then. You did all the hitting, you did all the scoring. and all the fighting. I mean, didn't you ever once in a while say, hey, what the hell's going on here?
No, not really. As a player, you grow up and you just have fun with the game. And that's any players coming in, they just want to play as much as they can and have as much fun as they can. And that's basically
well, I said that then. I said it on TV. I said, what the hell's going on? I didn't say hell, I don't think, if I remember. But I said, what's going on here? I said, here's the guy. We got 5'10", the leading goal scorer, and he's protected guy 6'2" that's got 3 goals. I don't understand that. So now he gets hurt protecting these big stiffs, and then they say, well, he's not scoring goals. I could never figure that one out. Anyhow, you play the same style as, well, not quite as good as Bobby Orr, but you still play the same way.
Not even close.
But what I meant was you play that hell-bent for leather. You go all the time. And I remember Donnie Meehan, and I used to go to Donnie, tell him to slow down. Don't hit so much. Take it easy. You know what Donnie said to me? You ever tell a bull terrier to slow down? But that's the way you play. Now, it's a tough atmosphere back then, wasn't it? I mean, it really was a tough atmosphere. You know, things were, everybody was, everybody else. Poor John Brophy, my friend, he never had a chance.
Well, there was a lot of controversy, right, from the top down, from the management through to the players and the coaching staff. I don't think it was very stable, but it was something that had been there for a long time. So it was tough for anybody that came in to play, but that's the way it was.
Well, Fletcher turned this around in a hurry, didn't he? I mean, he came in, the difference in the dressing room must have been dynamite.
Well, Cliff has made the biggest difference in the hockey club this year so far in the last couple of years. Just he stabilizes everything from an organization standpoint. He come in, he's upstairs, and he solidified upstairs. He's the boss, and he calls the shots, and it's something where everybody has confidence in him, and he knows, and everybody knows he's calling the shots. So it's like any other business. If it runs right at the top, it'll be run right down.
Not
the bottom.
Not a bad trade right off the bat with Gilmore.
Dougie's a pretty good player.
Yeah. I like that. Not a bad trade either, eh?
No, you get a player as good as Dougie Gilmore. He's a little guy that goes out there and gives 150% every night, and he's a guy that I think he has more fun at the game than anybody, and he can play it. Doesn't matter what style, and when he's your best player, and yet he gets along with everybody, and he'd rather be a mucker than a goal scorer sometimes.
Yeah, but the kind of everybody guy from Kingston is like that, and I tell you, now, Pat Burns, he was great, too. He just knew when to put the whip and take it off, right?
Well, Pat came in at the right time. I think after the first year after Cliff's been there, we got some players in together. Dougie had been there for half a year, and Jay McCowan and Rick Walmsley, some of the trades we had. And then Pat Burns came in and set a system up that probably one of the first times we had a system for a hockey club. Pat came in there and taught players the way he wanted the team to play. A lot of players had a lot of learning to do, and I'm one of them, and that's just one of the things where you have to learn how to play a different style to win. It's a team game, and when you win as a team, it's a lot more fun.
Got a little upset when you didn't play his style, eh?
Oh, he does. He does it that. That's like all coaches that want to win. He wants to win as bad as any player, and that's why he's going to get just as mad or as aggressive as anybody. And he's coach of the year and well-deserved.
Well, something like me in boxing. Yeah. Detroit series. What a series that be. I covered every game almost in the playoffs team, and that was the best series by far.
Well, I think that was a series where there was more highs and lows in one series than I've seen in a long time, from us losing both of the opening games and then winning the next three or whatever, and the tide shifted so many times in the whole series.
It was unbelievable.
It made it very exciting.
Well, I walked in Detroit, and I looked, and there was Mike Foligno sitting in reading a book in Detroit's lobby, and I said, what the hell's going on? You should be playing. Did he come back and inspire you guys the next game, right?
The kind of guy when he got set out there and he never takes it lightly, he comes back and he gives 110% every night, and if he misses a game, he's going to give it 200%.
Yeah.
He's somebody that he's loved by the whole team and everybody. He's something that's a character that you can't train or ask for. It's something that's just given to the player.
How about a broken leg and he comes back? That was one of the worst I'd ever seen.
It's one of the worst broken legs I've seen, and he come back, and it's just true dedication his part where he can come back and spent the whole summer, and, you know, he's been in the league 13, 14 years, and he spent the whole summer dedicating himself to come back to play.
I thought he was the better I think he was skating better than he did his rookie year, to tell you the truth.
Well, yeah. Finally probably trained in the summertime. He got in shape.
Yeah, well, that's for sure. That was the guy. Anyhow, in St. Louis series, Joseph was unbelievable for a while there, wasn't he?
Well, for the seven games or six games he played against us and the four he played against, probably the best goaltending I've ever seen in my life. He
Cujo.
He played 60 shots a night. He'd be stopping 59 of them, so it's the best I've ever seen.
We got Gilmore in that series, too. I think that was his best series, and he's from Kingston, so we got to run a little clip. You know, I always do that every from Kingston. Kirk Muller's coming, too. Okay, Blue, roll that there. Watch Gilmore. Unbelievable. Watch this. Greet him there with Todd Gill. What a year he had. I just thought of it. Boy, I'll tell you, of all the guys I've ever seen take slings and arrows for years and come back and play the way he did, the guys love him in the dressing room, don't they?
Well, Gill is a guy that gives it 100% every night. He'll give you the shirt off his back. He's about the same size as Dougie. Both of them are about the same size, and Todd plays defense, and he's been here 8-9 years, and everybody's been on his bandwagon and off his bandwagon, but he shows up every night and has as much character more than anybody in the league.
Oh, he's a beauty. L.A. series, boy, that was a series, too. You know, what a thrill that must have been coming off the bench in that sixth game and tying up that game. I mean, I was cheering for Leafs. Why not? Anyhow, I almost went to handstand. What a thrill that must have been, eh?
Well, it was very exciting. It was something where you don't normally see a goal come in and that happen. I just skated off the bench and...
Risk.
And Dougie, as usual, hit me wide open, so it's his credit to find me.
Well, just that, man, that goal coming right up. Blue, we got that goal coming up right now. Yeah, Tommy, yeah, here it comes. He's off the bench to pull the goal. There it is, Gilmore Stanley. He's a cover. Back.
And ties it here with 1:21 remaining in regulation time.
Of course, you got stiffed right after that. We won't say what. A cut. Dougie Gilmore hit his head on the ice, I guess, for the stick. We won't go into that. Now, Marty and McSorley and you had a nice little goal there. That was all right, that one. Marty's a good boy, though.
Marty's a great hockey player. He's really come into his own in the last 4 or 5 years. He's played in L.A. He's played defense. I think this last year he's playing just about 30 minutes a game and showing up every night, showing more than, you know, he can play the game as well, and he's something where he was a big difference.
Well,
in
I tell you, he was unbelievable. Again, another good friend of mine. We just have a little clip here. Watch this one, folks. I know you'll love this one. All right. Gilmore, get your head up. Get your head up. Don't leave now, because I want you to watch the credits. You're going to love it. It's on Rock'em Sock, and we're going to play it after. I want to ask you guys, well, I'll ask you, too. He had over 200 minutes of penalties, too. The instigator rule, pretty tough on you. You're the protector here. Pretty tough, isn't it?
Well, it is, but, you know, they're trying to change the game and clean it up, and, you know, it's always going to be there, but, hey, instigator rule ain't going to stop me from protecting my teammates.
Yeah, but what happens? When do you get thrown out? Like, you go, for instance, what I say is when Kasparaitis was knocking around Mario, Tocchet comes over, he's out of the playoffs. It's tough. I don't like the instigator rule, do you?
It's a tough call. It really puts a lot of pressure on the referees and the officials. I think it puts a lot more pressure than you think, sometimes can change the game if your goal scorer is also a guy that has to protect somebody.
Well, Solani, he's going to get it one of these times, and I know you don't need projecting. He had 200 minutes. Not only does he score, he puts the puck in. Now, we go to go. Would you love these here guys if you went to war with, I guess, eh? Now, folks, don't turn the TV off. We got a great titles running right now. We're going to show it right now. We'll see you next week. Thanks for tuning in. Here we go. Watch this now. Watch this here. Watch this here. Watch this coming. Run those titles.
Former Buffalo Sabre Rene Robert joins host Don Cherry on the next Grapevine. That's Tuesday, March 1st at 10:30 p.m. Eastern, 7:30 p.m. Pacific, and only right here on TSN.